Meeting of the Library Board of Trustees is now held to order. We will have a roll call of members. Here.
Member Graber.
Here.
Present.
I don't know, but like you said, you're here. All right. John is not where that is going to be now. Where is John?
I think he's out of town.
He's just out of town.
Yeah.
So, but it is an excused absence, and we're hoping that he can call in, but we're having some problems here, so we're not confident that will happen. General comment, if there's anybody here who has any business they want to bring up about the Library Board of Trustees and what they are responsible for, now is the time to come forward. 3 minutes, present your question or whatever. If you have nothing at this time, we will continue on. The minutes of the last meeting, did you all get your copies? Were there any additions or corrections that anyone needed to make? Okay, can I have a motion then?
I move to approve the minutes as presented.
Okay.
One second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
We are going to have a slight modification of the agenda in that we are going to move item 9B up to right after disclosures before the Friends of the Library report to make it more convenient for some of those people who are here just for the graduation. Okay? Are there any disclosures while we're talking about disclosures from any member of the board? Have you had any contact with public regarding an item that's on the agenda or any business of the Board of Trustees? Okay, seeing none. We will then move to item 9B, which is activities and operations of the library since the last report.
Do you guys want to go stand up and make that forward? So, my name is Tina Lloyd, I'm the library director, and my report today is going to be a little bit more animated than my normal written report, which you still can find in the back during the report section of your agenda. But we do have some, I would say, extremely special individuals here who were essentially our first cohort to go through the MT1, or Manufacturing Technician Certification Program. Now, that program is a pretty long time in the making. WNC, Emily Howarth, and Tammy Westergaard essentially had both gone to the Manufacturer Skills Institute at one point or another last year, looking at their program to solve some educational or workforce development needs in our community. And we were able, through an IMLS and the Nevada State Library and Archives and Public Records grant, create Nevada's Working Capital. And that's a partnership between WNC and the Carson City Library that allows students to take a self-paced or fast-track program here at the library, or take a full semester-based class that is embedded in the other classes that WNC teaches, and then they would graduate with their certification. So today we have two of our three graduates here with us, and I do want to just read, here's a little support letter from Ray Bacon of the Nevada Manufacturers Association about what's so important about the MT1 and why it's important for our community and for our region to have a workforce that has these skills needed to work in manufacturing. So in summary, the MT1 certificate program provides a workforce pipeline capable of meeting the requirements of existing and emerging employers in advanced technology industries such as manufacturing, a customized fast-track pathway to stackable credentials for incumbent and new hires to pursue 21st century career pathways to advance technology industry careers, and online and instructor-led training to address identified technical skill gaps. So these students went through the library's 8-week program. It was a very fast-track program, and graduated within the last week. That's why it is part of my director's report here today. We didn't want to put this off too much. And though I don't want to jinx anything that Kayla may have going for her, I did also want to let everyone here know before you see it in the paper that she has completed her second interview with Tesla, and it's looking very promising. So. Sam, would you like to come up?
Yes.
So Sam Wilson is one of our students that uses the library quite a bit and took interest in the MT1 program, and we are very excited. He actually was going to take self-paced in the library, take about a semester long to do it, and he finished about a month and a half early. So congrats, Sam. We have started to essentially offer this program as an informational session at the end of July of this last year. She was the first one in the door at the library. I want to do this. This is so exciting. I think I found my place. So congratulations, Kayla. Take a minute and have the board come up with our graduates and our trainer Jim Flip, and we're going to take a couple photos.
Oh, us.
So we have a professor. You guys have her.
Germany was supposed to be front center to that.
Report there, and I believe the chair is going to call for any public comment on this topic if they would like to.
Yes, at this time I will entertain a public comment if there's anybody who wants to make public comments on this program and the success that we've had so far.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the record, Ray Baker, the Manufacturers Association. This is an exciting time. Chris Holt's group, you can remember what he ran in NBA. Had a meeting, and Lance Nolan was in the meeting this week. Lance presented some information, and I'll just kind of relate it to you in general terms. It kind of goes like this. A part of it was in the newspaper this morning. There's pieces that were not in the newspaper. Between Switch, which is a technology job, even though it's not a manufacturing job, they're going to be using some pieces that are going to be in commonplace. So Switch is not off the table for kids in the Tesla and Panasonic, okay, that's someplace the man will put it about $12,000. And part of that's technology jobs, and part of that's manufacturing jobs. The manufacturing jobs will be the Tesla and Panasonic job. I'm sure that General Motors and Ford and Chrysler and Mercedes-Benz and Honda and Toyota are willingly going to give up market share so that Tesla can make half a million cars. But let's say that Tesla winds up being successful in getting that half a million cars a year. It may be 3, 4, 5, 6 years. That means the Panasonic side, to make the batteries that go in the cars, it's about 6,000 per car, they're about as big around as a C-cell, about half again that pipe. That's 8.2 million batteries per day, 365 days a year, 24/7. So it's going to be an interesting place to work. If the batteries are going to be made 24/7, Kayla's going to be working shift work 24/7 as well. That's the bad news part of that. The thing that Lance brought to the table that was interesting, though, is that there was another, he said, Fortune 100 company, that's somebody that's pretty good size, that is looking at us. They have eliminated several of the competitors on the thing that will be larger than Switch and Tesla put together. So when Elon is coming up with numbers that they're looking at 50,000 jobs in the designated sector, which is healthcare, manufacturing, technology, and of course mining doesn't have much in agriculture. But when he's talking about 50,000 jobs over the next 5 years, that's now starting to look like that's real. We all know, whether we'd like to admit it or not, that we have had a K-12 quality program for at least the last 50 years that I've been here. So this is going to focus. What this program does is it takes our kids that have got to drive, not necessarily kids, you think adults that are looking for second career. It takes those people that have got the driving and stamina to get in there, find out whether we can fix those problems that they've got in their career, to get to the point where they've got something which is presentable in an industry-recognized credential. The nice thing with this program, as well as the National Career Readiness Certificate, seen it very, very well there, is those are scored based upon a national standard, not something where we set the standard, we might tweak the standard a little bit. But they're set at a national level so that we wind up with something that truly means we have a measurement that shows what we are hiring is competitive on the national basis. So we're a fundamental change type program. The next 5 years are not going to be fun because they're going to be pushed right to the metal all the time. But I take a look at what these kids are going to do because they're getting it on the ground floor. They can easily go through 2, 3, 4 promotions in the next 5 years. That's pretty exciting. Actually, and share with some of these. Thank you.
To be successful, and then talk to you about those areas that We either, as a staff, would like some more clarification, where the board would like us to go to those items. Possibly those items are completed, or possibly those items are just not necessary to have in the plan anymore. So with that, our first strategic goal is to inspire learning. Now, it's not that we don't do these things anymore, story times, or story times with play, hands-on story times, but we have focused more towards the technology side of learning in the digital age. So what you'll see here, in measuring success, this is actually from how you measure success in your strategic plan at that last part of the first goal. What you'll see here is a year-over-year, a steady increase of virtual patrons engaging in all aspects of public library service. So up until almost a year ago now, we had a website, we had no analytics. We would not be able to tell you who clicked on our website, who visited what page, how, any of that. We did go through a complete redo of our website, funded in part and pushed in part by the strategic plan. And what you'll see here is from when it launched in January, the increase, especially during summer, but the increase of users, so visits and page views on our website. So that's what you see here, where my laser is pointing us. So we're in September, because we haven't finished October yet. In September, we're right about 20,000 page views and right about 13,500 page visits, which is not bad for a site that we get redirected from the Carson.org website quite a bit when they're coming to look for library information. So then you'll see here, this map is just the month of September. People using our website, their locations. They're not just using our website from Nevada. They're using it from all over the world, but specifically the United States. So I would say that we are engaging our community and outside of our community pretty significantly in the virtual field. So our next item is digital objects are produced using library tools, quality and quantity of objects increase. And we actually have some students sitting over here in this booth, working on digital objects. And that's one of our goals. It's one of the goals of this space in particular, the Digitorium space. And these are just clips from our YouTube channel. The one up here at the top, I've been doing This Week at Your Library on YouTube. It's about a minute to 2 minutes, and we've actually seen significant views of that, as much as I would rather not be on YouTube. We also see Dale Arpiagua here promoting banned books and banned books week. Not promoting banning books, promoting not banning books. And we have Rachel here on the stage that we're looking at, recording her reading of a banned book. We have the dawn of the technology zombies, technological zombies, which was produced by our teams a couple years ago, but did win the best in our state. And then down here at the bottom, we have the freshman PSA, the public service announcement that was shown at the Galaxy Theater. So again, I would say that we're doing a pretty good job producing these digital objects and increasing the quality of those objects that we're producing. Every time we get on iMovie, there's probably a new update, and we learn something new each time. So that is a big piece of it as well. I can't tell what they're working on right now. Okay, so this is where we do need to have discussion under the inspired learning part of our strategic plan. Some of these items we did map to the city strategic plan about how we could address what we have in our strategic plan and what the city has in their strategic plan. And I'm going to go by this slide, and we will come back to this slide to have that discussion. So our next goal is facilitating connection. This individual here was interviewed for our newsletter in August, and essentially his story was that he came to the library because nobody could help him, and he thought, oh, I'm just going to call the library and see if they know how to help me get all of my MP3s back on the CDs so that I can do my music, because he plays music in the background, and then he, I think it's a guitar, and then he plays his guitar but with music going on in the background, so he doesn't have to have a full band. And so the library was able to help him do that. It's actually Susan who helped him do that. But so in measuring success, we also have our community is digitally inclusive and has widespread broadband adoption. I think that slowly but surely this is happening. Carson High School just did their one-to-one launch of, Alan, can you tell me how many computers you guys put out? So, you know, those computers come to the library. They connect their, you know, their Chromebooks, so they have to connect to the internet to really have a lot of applications on them. But what we've done at the library here is we've worked on our Wi-Fi. You can now actually leave this room and go walk through the rest of the library and stay on one connection. And as of October 16th, we have fiber in this building, public fiber in this building. So our patrons are experiencing better upload times. If they're choosing to watch Netflix or if they're choosing to watch lynda.com, there is no lag now. So that has been an increase, at least on our part, to address this within our community. We also are reading books in all formats and have connected to the person when they need it and when they want it. So what you're going to see here, it says 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way to 12, but this is by fiscal year. So this is last July, and this one right over here is June. So we've had a pretty significant increase in ebook usage over the year. And that's with putting much less of an investment into our ebooks than we do into our print books. Significantly less. Then you'll also see here a chart that has FY 12, 13, and 14, and the number of users increase in the blue, and then the number of checkouts increase in the red and the orange. These are individuals who are checking out items on their phone, their iPad, their tablet, their Kindle, any of those items. This does not include the Kindles that we circulate here at the library with preloaded ebooks on them. These are just items that they can check out themselves on their own devices. So again, here's discussion. These are some things that we do need to talk about. This one in particular, this top one, appears in two of our goals. So our last goal is to create opportunity. And who you will see here is Kayla and Brittany in the MT1 room, which who in here knows where that is? Okay, that's actually behind this green screen. We've taken and converted a janitorial closet essentially into our MT1 classroom. So there are 9 student seats, and then there's 1 instructor computer. And so that's, you know, they're studying, they're in class with Jim in this picture. Here's another picture from that class. So the library is recognized as a central player in economic development. We did receive from the chamber the best for economic development award in 2015, partially because of this MT1 program, what we were going to be able to bring to the community from what we're doing. We're also measuring success with a high percentage of community student graduates who who are career and college ready, that they demonstrate reflective learning, independent learning, inquiry, and curiosity, and that they work in teams. Those that you'll see here were the groups that won the PSA contest last year for the freshman PSAs. That's in Carson. So these are the areas where we're going to want to discuss either how do we get there, what exactly do you want us to do to get there, should it even still be one of our goals that we set forth. So with that, I'm going to go right back to Inspire Learning. And Diane here is going to be the scribe so that we can try and get the content of what the board would like to see in the strategic plan, so we can bring it back to the board that those comments can be reflected in the edits to the strategic plan. Okay. So with Inspiring Learning, we talk about the summer reading programs quite a bit. This is something that doesn't just engage readers in story times, this engages readers all summer long. One of the goals here was to expand the summer reading program to be a meaningful linked year-round enrichment program by assigning the responsibility and timetables for multi-level contacts with school administrators, principals, teachers, school librarians, and promote documented relationships between library services and student performance. So, with that, does the board have any comments, discussion, anything that they would like to say?
Is that
going
to be run the same way as the summer?
It's possible. Well, currently, so this, the strategic plan is a board, the board decided that this is the direction that they wanted to go. We're looking for direction on what you want this to look like, what you guys think it should look like. Should it include prizes? We do have programs and other activities that we do year-round. So we're looking for some direction. Do you want us to be more of a contact with school administrators, principals, Alan, other teachers? Are we creating a formal program in this sense, or are we continuing to do what we've done well in the past to fulfill this goal?
I don't think it would be important. We have talked about the school administrators and teachers, because that's the whole purpose of summer reading, is to keep the kids from kind of slipping backwards while they're out of school. So maybe the teachers could help come up with reading lists or something like that.
Find what out?
How many adults took place in the summer reading program?
They took part.
Like okay. Susan.
Susan or Andy?
Okay.
I don't have the number on the line.
Here's a couple.
They gave prizes as coupons to the books. Yes. There were several that really
were. Right. They got money.
Zero, two, one. rewarded for being achievers. I mean, it's helpful to be happy.
So are you asking if they're looking at an integration with those literature lists?
Those were mostly for at high school level.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the, middle school or elementary school, so. I think we're trying to catch them earlier in the age range, childhood than high school, so I don't know if that's relevant.
I think it would still apply. We do have readers who, the more they read, the better they're going to read. Practicing perfect.
Would it mean that everybody was reading the same thing, or they could pick five out of the list of 20, or something like that? And they'd have to write some kind of answer question, so we know they actually read it, I don't know.
Well, I mean, it very well could, that's essentially, we don't assign any reading during our current summer program, but the teens do write reviews, short ones, but they write reviews, right?
We took those away because they weren't doing it.
Did more teens participate this year than last year?
Heather would have a comparison. I think our numbers this year were comparable to last year. We lost some people in the younger crowd, and we had gains among the older kids. Do you want me to explain what we do now for the summer reading program, just as a summary for the board?
Sure. For frame of reference, that would be great.
So for the record, Aubrey White, Library Assistant. I work in the Youth Department of our city library. So what we've done in the past is we had a different structure depending on the age range. And so the youngest kids, the toddlers, would do something different from what the elementary school kids would do than from what the middle school and the high school kids would do. What we found, though, was that depending on the age range, they didn't like it, or they didn't want to do it, or they wanted to do what the other kids were doing. So we tossed that model out, and we just went to a flat model where it kept track of the amount of time that they spent reading. And so everyone just had to keep track of the amount of time that they spent reading throughout the program, and then they would be awarded points based on the amount of time that was spent reading. And we felt that that model was more appropriate because then it didn't matter if you had, readers who maybe only read 15 to 20 pages in an hour, whereas you had the kid who finished an entire novel in a couple of hours. So that way it leveled the playing field for everyone. We also moved away from keeping track of it via paper and stickers and coloring sheets. We used an entirely online program, which we've had positive remarks. The parents loved it, that they didn't have to worry about remembering paper. We've had other people who have said, well, they like letting their kid color. But I think overall, the reaction has been positive in that they didn't have to remember anything. They could either do it online, where they could record, they would just input on their own account the amount of time they spent reading, or they could come in and they could tell us, hey, I need to log into my account, I spent this amount of time reading. And it was also nice because we always had issues where you could tell there was that one kid that was always done the next day, like he just went on a 24-hour reading marathon. Well, now we could see where people were obviously fabricating the information that they're putting in, because they would put in ridiculous amounts of time and you just saw them at the library 5 minutes before that. No, you didn't read 1,000 minutes since I saw you. In terms of prizes, what we did is we had a flat, and once everyone hit a certain number of minutes at the halfway point, they received a prize. Once they got to the end, they received a prize, and then they were entered into drawings for the grand prize. And then we gave out a bunch of door prizes at the actual end of the summer reading program party. And we didn't really require anything from them to read, but we did try to incentivize them by of creating book lists. And a lot of times we did it just by genre or theme or topic. But if they read a certain number of books off of, say, the dystopian YA fiction book list, they would receive bonus points for doing that. So that's definitely something that you could apply to a year-round program. You could, you know, allow kids to participate and they could read whatever they want. But if, say, you've got lists of books from teachers that either they want the kids to read or feel that that's the level they should be reading, you could then incentivize them in the same way. You could give them bonus points for completing this book list. Because what it ultimately was is you reached, I think it was 1,700 points or 1,800 points. You reached a certain number of points and then you completed the program. And so a certain number of points was halfway through the program. And the best way that they earned the points was just by reading 3 minutes. But then we also had programs at the library where they would earn points for attending. And the reading list that I talked about. So there's a lot of different ways that you can motivate participants to help them to not just do the bare minimum in the program. Any questions?
Typically, the kind of student or participant in this program, would you kind of characterize, is that a person who you're being encouraged to maybe do something remedial to improve their reading skills, or are these people who are already pretty squared away and they're just looking for an additional challenge, or typically who does the program, whose attention are we getting, who's signing up, who's showing up?
I would honestly say it's a mixture of both. It'd be nice to look at the actual statistics, and we can compare using the website. I don't have any reports in front of me. We can compare how many people began the program and reached a certain level as opposed to how many people completed the program. Because what often happens is we have a lot of participants sign up, a much fewer number that actually complete the program and go through and read the requisite number of hours to complete the program. So I would say that it's both, because there's some kids who their parents make them participate, and then there's the kids who they're in here every week getting books, and I can probably rattle off their names because they're back there right now, I'm sure, getting their next set of books. So it's really both. I would say, of course, it caters more to the kids who want to read, because I mean, if you're good at it, why not get prizes for doing it? But we do get both.
Yeah. Trustee Graber again. I'm kind of thinking, you know, if we want to do this, if it's feasible in terms of budget and person hours, it sounds like it's a pretty challenging, pretty aggressive plan. That maybe if there would be some way that we could target, higher learning, if we could maybe modify the program to where we really had a particular target audience that we're going after. Like, and I mean, I don't know if that makes sense to me. We're trying to be some kind of remedial reading slash literacy program or what, or if we, you know, like made it a certain, like you said, genre of book, you know, or something. I just don't know. But it seems to me like instead of keeping it, seems really broad, and if we tapered it or tailored it, maybe that would be more doable, at least on the front end, as a pilot program. I don't know, it's hard for me to understand, I guess because I've never participated, it's hard for me to understand exactly how it works and how what kinds of successes occur that really could be chalked up under Aspire Learning.
I've seen a lawyer. Spoken about in the past, about the library having more involved.
And I think the question buried in there was, can we set up different programs using that same website? The answer would definitely be yes. We can, I believe we purchased access for the entire year. So we can set up an additional program. Heather E-Services Librarian, Heather Butler, was the administrator on the website. So I know from her work on that website that you can just create a program and say, hey, this is for second grade and under, and have people sign up and use the website that way.
And Heather does regret that she cannot be here today. She is on her.
Excuses.
Come on.
She's gonna call it.
Trustee Pat, do you know if we expanded this sort of thing like all we were just describing for a full year, would that impact staffing and budget?
Depending on how involved it was, or it is, it could impact staffing, which also impacts budget. Just depending, but that's something that we can examine with some direction on moving forward, and that we can present to you something that would essentially take place of this item, I think, in the strategic plan that's more focused and more specific.
So I see possibilities with the pilot program, and like you said, the white third grade kind of thing, but that could also be applied to adults who are having trouble learning to read. Expanded later on if it's successful. That's inspiring learning, not just to kids, but the whole community. So now you're looking for a direction from us? Is that what you're...
This is not actually an action item, so it's just presentation and discussion. But I think we're getting some direction by you guys, your comments that we're writing up here. If we write something down wrong that you would like to have said differently, do tell us. And that will be coming back to you as a board. But so if we're done talking about that topic, let's go on to the next two. They relate to each other. The first one is seek a deputy sheriff or a security person stationed in the library. That's listed in here as a discussion item in red. And then provide a secure facility where people feel safe and comfortable, which is also highlighted. A little bit of background on this topic. When Tammy Westerner was here as the interim director, there was a conversation with the sheriff's department to potentially put a mobile deputy station here in the library. There were some issues. There was a little bit of interest shown by the sheriff's office, but at the time, we also were not connected to the city's network and infrastructure, which would have made it more difficult than it would at this time. So we do think we don't necessarily need somebody stationed in the library, and that's their location. But if they're coming in to fill reports out, providing them a space potentially, to the idea is to provide them a space to fill out their reports, to get some donuts that we would bring to them, that kind of thing. Be in this environment, because we do have a couple deputies actually who come and use the library on their off time, and we do see some of our patrons who, I don't want to say are problems, but can create problems, have a little bit more respect when they are in this, going to be a deputies in the space. So that, I mean, that's kind of the idea behind also providing a safe facility where now, that being said as well, we do have items that are stolen from the library. I don't want to say on a daily basis because it isn't that frequent, but DVDs, I know Diane has experience being found in some of the situations, that steamers get peeled off, the RFID tags on the DVDs get peeled off, in the dark corners of our library, because our alarm system does not have cameras. So there's a couple solutions that I think that could provide a safe or secure facility where people feel safe and comfortable without necessarily putting a deputy or a security guard in the space. One of those things would be adding cameras to our current system. It would not be without cost, but it is an option. It would be much less than an ongoing cost than personnel.
Where would the screens be?
I would believe back in the staff space. Nowadays, some of the items that we've looked at with that could go compatible with the security system, you can actually log on to it from any station in the library. So, you know, if a staff member suspected or was just at their desk, they could bring it up and watch it and monitor, and then it also records. So then if we do find a bunch of those stingrays stuck together hidden underneath the shelf, then we can go back and look at when that may have happened. Yes, ma'am.
Trustee Graber, on the officers who come here to do reports idea, do they need a private space in which to do those reports? And if so, do we know that?
That was not completely discussed at the time when Tammy was here because we didn't have that network connection.
Mm-hmm.
I would assume that they would need somewhat of a private space. And we are short on space, so it is a possibility, but if they were to be seen, then they're not going to be in a private space. So that part does make it kind of difficult, but if that's something that the board wants to see continued action on, now that we have the networking and fiber to potentially do something.
For the record, Trustee Hayes. Now, in Henderson, at the recreation centers and things like that, the HPD, the Henderson Police Department, is actually encouraged to just come to the parking lot where they, you know, fill out their paperwork for their, you know, speeding infractions and things like that. And we found that just that presence of having, you know, an HPD squad car in our parking lot was enough to cut down on, you know, like you were saying, some of the problem patrons that would come in and things like that. So I wonder if something like that would be sufficient if we were to just touch base with Carson City PD and say, you know, if you've got time that you're going to be filling out this paperwork anyway and you're going to be sitting in your squad car while you're doing it, why not do it in our parking lot? So, and that seemed to work for him, at least.
One of the things that we wanted to talk about a little bit
Trustee Hayes, for the record, I would assume that something like that could be handled through the mobile site. I would have to see, you know, exactly what you want to do on the app that would be better handled through.
Well, I'm not advocating for us to go forward with an app, because I do think that our very mobile friendly website is sufficient to do everything that we need to do. But this is something that was in here that, you know, if we're not gonna go in that direction, then that is something I would suggest that we remove from.
Ideas on that line?
Do you have a way to tell how many people are using mobile apps in there? If you're talking to the friends of the library,
one of the graphs that I didn't put up there for the website is a pie chart that essentially tells you with all of this access, who's accessing it from what devices. The benefit to a mobile friendly website is like with your iPad, you can pull it up and it scales everything. It doesn't shrink text or blow text up and make it really hard to read. But our website is mostly accessed from mobile devices and not a Mac or a PC.
Demographically, how many people do you think are using the website?
Our website?
Would be using mobile apps.
Versus our website, yeah.
It's a guess.
So basically, what was the share in that pie chart?
Yeah, what would be the group that would want to use an app versus using the web page? That's hard.
I know. I'm just looking at the age demographic.
I don't want to say the problem here because it's not a problem,
right?
But I mean, even Noe and Bryce, you know, and Sarah over here, if they like you can use a website, like you can bookmark it like an app on your device, and so I don't even know if they know what the difference website that's bookmarked as an app on your device is. Okay. What would you prefer? We have some of this demographic, right? So if you're accessing the library's website, this is Sarah, for the record. If we had an app, would you use that over our website?
Probably, yes. Depending on if you search the catalog.
I don't know when I'm allowed to sort of say that. I'm used to being over there and I'm not allowed to talk.
Library system, I'll be right. I would say that basically what they just said is true. When dealing with patrons from day to day, the only way our patrons would be interested in an app is if it was also integrated with their client website. Like, we use websites for two things, to find out something or to get something. So if you can't combine both of them, and that would have to be a talk with Dana Hines over at the State Library, if you can't combine that into a single app, then I don't think that the app approach, like I'm on our website right now, and our website looks phenomenal on my phone. Like the website looks fine by itself. But if you could integrate both into a single app, that would make our patrons very happy. The only thing is I don't have the technical savvy to know if that can even
happen. I can answer that question. That's a question I can answer. Polaris does not have that capability at this time.
Mr. Spencer, you'd like to comment.
For the record, Joseph Spencer, Vice President of the Friends of the Carson City Library. I think the main question that we should be asking ourselves is what is the goal that we are trying to attain between the purpose of an app versus the information we're trying to communicate on a website. The example that I'm going to cite here is Southwest Airlines. Southwest Airlines is a very friendly app to book flights, check in, and look at your rapid rewards. That's it. It serves a purpose. So whereas, if you want to develop an app for the library, what is the purpose? What is going to be different in the app that you don't already do on the website? So perhaps what you consider is making the website mobile friendly versus...
See, yeah, it sounds like the reason that we spent as much money as we did on the website is so that it was mobile friendly.
And that was a lot of the development, because without the development behind the website, you can't make it mobile friendly. Like, it has to be developed in that way. And some of you, if you recall, our previous website, not so great on the phone or iPad.
Trustee Gregor. Okay, so like Joe said, on the Southwest app, people can check in, they can look at the rapid rewards things, and I don't know, you think three things.
Book
so flight. What would be one of the three main items that people do would be put them on the website?
They search our catalog, they use our databases off of it, and those are the two main pages.
But do one of those two require the Polaris thing?
Yes.
And you just said the Polaris could not for who not the act?
Yeah, it's only a website. And it's mobile friendly, but it's a website.
If we had that, it would need to be redundant. It would fall short.
Correct.
Okay, I think we should take it out.
Okay. If Polaris ever does come out with that, I will let us know, you guys. Okay. So the last item for Inspire Learning is volunteer involvement collaborations are maintained and expanded that service fundamental needs like reshelving materials and teaching basic computer skills. So in this area, what you'll see is that we have a teen advisory board. We allow ESL volunteers to use our spaces here in the library. We do background check all of our volunteers, but that's cost. Funds. We get $24 background check. And we try to do that after they've made the promise of volunteering versus just filled out their application and then we submit it. And they've gone through the volunteer training and then they submit their background check. Just so that there is an additional cost to the library that would be seen back in volunteers volunteering. So I think what we're trying to discuss here is, I know the Friends have a huge, huge base of volunteers that essentially run that bookstore, and we don't want to steal from those volunteers for our programs. That would be bad for the Friends, that's bad for the library as well. But, you know, is there direction? Do we want to expand our volunteer base? Do we want to try and get more community individuals involved in giving back their time and talent and energy into the library in different ways? We have one of those volunteers sitting with us.
I work in the DVD section of the building, but I know that there's always at least three carts full of books that need to be reshelled, and I'm over there tomorrow. Just the DVD section, and that's only a very small part of the entire library that needs reshelving. And as far as where to find more volunteers, how about churches?
So what I'm kind of looking here too a little bit is, you know, should we expand and make our volunteer program more robust?
Maybe robust,
more volunteers.
There's always a paper sign hanging in the doorway that says we need more shelvers.
Joe worked for the record liaison office. This is discussion, not an action item, and it's very start to deliberate towards decisions as not actually agenda as an action item, you may tentatively start to cross the line. Yes, it's difficult to have this information gathering process and discussion without perhaps coming very close to the line and deliberating towards a decision. So I just want to throw that out here. It's one fine. I hate to be the bucket of ice water. I don't want to complaints.
Thank you for the reminder.
Yes. Thank you.
So do you guys have any more comments that you want to make about our volunteer program?
Now that we're afraid to speak.
Wanting to derail the train, James.
There would be a net benefit. Sure, it sounds as though to continue to be open to having volunteers and or possibly working towards some kind of a growth of volunteer program would be great. We want to do what works for you. That's all there is to it. Bottom line, we want to do what helps the library function as efficiently as it can. And if our efficiencies are somewhat limited by the fact that we don't have enough volunteers to kind of help fill those gaps, then sure, I think including volunteer involvement and collaboration is something that we probably ought to leave on our list. It sounds like a valid point that holds up some of the underpinnings of our strategic plan.
I do just want to make the comment that with more volunteers comes the necessity of having a volunteer coordinator to make sure that all of that is working in line.
Well, net gain. It's yep. Got to be a net gain. Yeah, it's got to help you.
Okay. Is there any more discussion on inspiring learning?
Any more public comment on that?
Okay, so the next is facilitate connection. And the first item that we will see is connect online learners to numerous distance education opportunities. This is in facilitate connection as well as create opportunity. We were looking for a little bit more direction input from the board as to what the meaning of this was after providing lynda.com to our community. And, you know, is this like WEGU, which is Western Governor National University? Are we wanting to contact them? But just some comments from the board.
Have you looked at like Coursera and things like that? Are you promoting that to the library?
The library does have a page that discusses online free learning opportunities like Coursera. If you want to get a certificate, it does cost money through Coursera. But there really is no way for us to track what patrons use or do not use those services.
Oh.
That webpage, yes, like who accesses that page. But those, they're not going to give us that phone or that information. Something. You want to come in?
All right. One potential area in here is looking at, you know, online distance learning, but one thing that has come up in discussion and looking at some other plans within the library and grant possibilities would be certifications. MT1, this is an on-site certification, but there are other programs on certifications that are online or potential distance. So I didn't know if that was an item that had been considered or you want to consider. Or we want to specifically sell it out.
Okay, I can go at it if you, if that reflects your need. Okay.
Off on objective six as well, because it's pursue increased funding from the city and so you can kind of find them on your pages. Okay. Nothing. Okay. So with that, as an informational, you have this from our last meeting. This is the chart in which you stuck sticky notes on the board. I transcribed it to the best of my ability. Please do review and take a look at those. And then on the back of that is also the other side of the board. And the comments were made that were made there as well. In addition, we had a couple members of the public who are here today who made some of these comments. So I think taking a look at this for the next meeting would be of importance. Okay, so with that, shall we move on?
Yes.
This is an action item. We can have discussion and I can answer questions. So, this is discussion and possible action for moving forward with LSTA 2016 grants. So what you're going to see in your packet are two proposals. They were due September 16th.
John, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Hey, can everybody hear John? John, say hi.
Hi.
Hi, John.
Hey, John.
Turn the volume up a little bit.
Oh,
that's already up. Say hi again, John.
Hello.
That's better.
Way better.
Okay, hi John.
Hi.
Can you hear me well?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. So we're at the point on the agenda, and we're sorry that you didn't pack it. We experienced some very massive problems with emails quite recently. So we're on the action item discussion of possible action on moving forward with LSTA 2016 grants. So in the packet, there's two page proposals that were submitted to submitted to the State Library Archives and Public Records. They are IMLS grants, similar to what we have right now with the manufacturing technician, and our Habits of Minecraft. So in taking a look at these, we're looking for approval from the board to move forward with doing a full proposal, a full application to LSTA. One of these, the mini grant, is a grant for a Nobly Zone grant, so working on developing our collection and programming to address no-bullying, which is a law that was put into place this year, and the school district does have to deal with considerably. So this would, I would say that this would be in partnership with the school district, though I have not yet checked with them, in moving forward with developing a collection that not only helps students, but that also helps teachers in dealing with some of these situations. So that's our mini grant, that's up to $5,000. And then we have our mobile makerspace, and that grant is focusing on our lack of space here at the library and looking at developing a mobile makerspace that we can take to after school programs.
programs, 4-H, Boys and Girls Club, to the schools that have STEM-based learning or STEAM-based learning in them. There's no guarantee that we write the grant, that we get the grant, but this is just, this is moving forward so that we will do a full application and submit that. We probably will find out about it in between January and June of next year if we do receive these grants for FY 17. Are there any questions?
Trustee Pat, I don't have any questions, but I think these two items are certainly worth pursuing. They kind of fit in with our collaboration with the school district and the fact that we are out of space here and still want to try to keep going with the STEAM focus things that we want the kids to learn. So I say go ahead with your applications.
We're looking for a motion and a discussion.
But if you...
I do have a question.
Okay.
Trustee Graber. I understand, I mean, I'm reading about maker spaces and it kind of tells what it does, what the outcomes are, and what it works for. What does it look like? What is it? Is it a program? Is it a book van? Is it a...
It would be, so what, one of the items that we are looking at is our city van to potentially use, because we only use 2 days a week for other deliveries, but using that essentially type of vehicle, putting a vinyl in it, so making it stand out. STEAM-based, you know, kind of chemistry, a really neat-looking van that catches kids' attention in a positive way.
Like a rolling molecule.
Yeah. And then using that space, bins, tables that can come out of the van, and then we set up a mobile makerspace wherever we can.
Thank you.
Why is the project cost zero?
Projected cost.
Yeah, what is the projected cost?
The projected cost with the required match was $34,500.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
Diane Baker, for the record, the projected cost for the mobile makerspace, including the required match, would be $34,500. The required match on all of these grants is 10%.
Does that include the kids that the library supply? It says on the back to the library, identify and purchase kits and curriculum.
It's going to be a combination, and that's one of the discussion items with this particular program. Has been revamped quite a bit lately, and so we are discussing the best way to identify the match, because it's reportable not only to the state library, but to the federal level. And the easiest way to provide a confirmed match that has the least, you know, least amount of impact on our reporting. So that is, it's easier to report specific purchased items. So yes, the library may use specific purchased items as opposed to reporting in-kind time, because that there are more requirements, and federal rules changed last December on the level of reporting required for that type of reporting.
John, do you have any?
I was looking at it. I'm in support of both of them. I think the local space maker is really needed for the marketplace. And the no bullies, I think, is going to be something that everybody's going to have to do to make it successful, just by our end. And I think the mobile maker space has incredible potential. I really like that.
Both of them together, and one of them individually.
have that, you have a calendar in your packet. And the problem with meeting on a fourth Thursday in November or December is they're both on holidays. So I would like to request that we not meet between December 4th and 14th. However, if we do, Diane can be a replacement, depending on how your calendars work for myself, as I will be not in this
meeting. I know in the past, why you just have one meeting someplace in the middle of the 2 months.
Yes.
So, December 3rd seems like an obvious choice. I mean, are you meeting on the 4th?
That works.
But that would work. That would kind of get us kind of right in the middle. And it keeps us on the same day of the week anyhow.
Yeah.
So, again, does anyone make a motion that we all...
You guys are really matching with me. I'm going to be in Utah that week.
You're going to be in Utah that week?
Yeah. Don't ask me, I'll see if I can do this together.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. So, somebody want to make a motion? I'm glad to make a motion, Madam Chair, that we do kind of like a combination November-December meeting and have it instead of the last Thursday of November meet on the first Thursday of December, which is December 3rd.
Aye.
Okay. Need to remote in, John. You get it.
I try. That's like my wife. Every time I try to put it down,
she changes it. Well, maybe it'll change again by then. Okay. So then we still do need to do item A.
Okay, so you have a tab in your packet that says budgets, supporting materials, and behind that you'll see the Carson City General Fund 101, and that's just the detailed budget report, each of our line items, and how they are spent. Are there any questions on any of those? I would like to tell you why equipment and repair and maintenance has a 22 negative. That's actually not negative dollars, but actually is an indication that there is more money in that budget than what was budgeted for. And because we received a credit essentially from last fiscal year, but it came into this fiscal year and shouldn't have. And I believe at this time the city is not going to be able to fix it just because of how they're trying to wrap up last year's budget, and so that just means that we have a little bit more money, or what does it have to be? Okay.
Maybe that needs to fix our sign.
we have we're working on a quote for that. So under the gift fund, what you'll see, there's a few pages here. Are there any questions on gift funds? There has been a lot of funds that have been expended from the gift fund. The majority of those funds have been expended for the reason of the friends money that comes in to, one, match our grants, and to, two, our book lease is a large chunk of what we spend in our gift fund. But what you'll also see are the computers purchased for the MT1 and all of, or an additional MT1 expenses as well. chunk of the gift fund money, but that is broken down here so that you can see where we've gone over a little bit on some areas, and facilities, fixtures, we're under in furnishings, we're over on equipment and under in the program infrastructure, but bottom line, we still have $1,561.33 in the FFNE. This FFNE was the budget that was essentially, or the amount of money that was essentially approved with the strategic plan as how we were going to be able to stay in this building for the time being, for right now. This is what we needed to be able to fix and do to be able to stay here and serve our patrons. You'll see the website rebuild on there. It actually came under $10,000 by $275. Is there any additional questions? Yes.
Joe, is it appropriate to ask for an update on the gates?
On the gates?
Which is an item on this,
absolutely,
this section.
Okay, so the FFNE on the FFNE. So the doors at the gate? Well, so the doors at the gate is actually, that's what we have, the sliding metal. That's that piece there. And then the gates that were actually purchased for the secret garden space. And so those are up and working as well.